forever. Dog.
When your first choice is a big old bus,
you turn around and boom, you end up with us. Sloppy seconds. Oh, diva.
Our number is 213-536-9180. Our email is sloppysecondspod@gmail.com. Now on with the show. Are you ready for some sloppy seconds? Are you stupid little fucks, you nasty little fucks, you dirty little fucks? I hope you're staying home. I hope you're having a wonderful holiday season. And don't forget, Amazon is the devil. I'm Big Dipper, and that's Meatball. Welcome back to Sloppy Seconds with Big Dipper and Meatball. How are you doing, Big Dip?
You know, speaking of Amazon, I'm trying to shop for this new apartment. Should I get a food processor? Is that a thing?
Yes.
That I should own?
Yes.
Because it needs to be like, I need to get something that I can like do a lot of different things in, but I don't
want
to
have
like.
You need to get one of those
like,
big old blenders that everyone gets that's got like 8 blades at the bottom and it's like super powerful and you can use it as a food processor, a blender, a smoothie maker. Juicer.
Is it also the one that has like the long pole in it that you can jam in the top?
That's the one, okay. Ma.
That's like a Vitamix. That's like a legit.
Get you a Vitamix.
Ass. I bought my sister a juicer when she moved into her new apartment, and then she said to me there, she was like, "I made nut butter from the juicer, and it has a pasta attachment because all the juicer is like a really good motor,
mm-hmm.
and then you just like put the attachment on it, so theoretically you can do these other tasks."
That's awesome. You should get one.
I really want to like flex in my kitchen because I've never owned kitchen supplies. I've always sort of like moved somewhere and be like, oh, do you have pots and pans? In fact, all of my pots and pans are Lauren's. She gave me like a whole bunch of them because she was like, I have all these extra ones. And I'm like, great. So like everything I have is like borrowed or, you know, inherited from someone. So I want to step my kitchen up a little bit.
I think you should. I often get really upset when I go to my friends' houses and they're like, yeah, grab the knife. And it says IKEA on it.
Girl.
And I was like, we are not in college anymore. This isn't going to cut anything.
I only have one knife right now, but it's a good ass knife. And I bought the thing. Not a stone, but a...
The leather strap?
No.
You got a leather strap and you're...
No. That's for shaving your face. I bought a...
It's a metal rod that's kind of rough.
Yeah.
Okay, give me more shapes. Yes, it's Play-Doh. It's a Play-Doh machine. He sharpens his knife with a Play-Doh machine.
And I use that to make my nut butter.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah. Okay, so thank you. I just needed someone to encourage me to get a food processor.
I say get one of those. It's also something that if you have the money to, get one of those Kenmore standing kitchen mixer things. They're just like, you can make bread in it, you can make your pasta in it, you can make anything in it.
A KitchenAid?
Yeah, sure.
Wow, that's like a big purchase.
It's an adult purchase, yes, but you are now in your own apartment and it's time to start acting like an adult.
Do you know what my grandfather was doing at 35? He had grandkids. All right, let's take a break and we'll be right back with our special guest. Okay, we talk a lot about butthole and butthole adjacent things on this podcast.
So we love that Hello Tushy is our sponsor.
And it is the gifting season, so what better present than a freshly washed arsehole?
Yes, this hole-a-day season, may your home be filled with joy and may your butthole be as clean as a freshly driven snow thanks to Hello Tushy.
Okay, so for years, bidets have cost thousands of dollars. I didn't believe this, but I looked it up. Thousands of dollars and available only to rich people.
The Hello Tushy modern bidet attachment is there to democratize the blessings bestowed by bidets and offer clean buttholes to everyone. That's a lot of bees, baby.
So Hello Tushy attaches to your existing toilet. No electricity or additional plumbing is needed. And it cleans your butt with a precise stream of fresh water. All for just $79.
Every Hello Tushy bidet attachment comes with a 60-day risk-free Happy Butt Guarantee and a 12-month warranty for your butt.
So stop wiping your butt and start washing. And join millions of happy Hello Tushy customers right now. Makes a great gift to send to all the people with butts in your family. You got a butt. They got a butt. She got a butt. He got a butt.
Get 10% off plus free shipping right now at HelloTushy.com. /sloppy.
That's hellotushy.com. That's Tushy, T-U-S-H-Y. Hellotushy.com/sloppy for 10% off and free shipping.
Hellotushy.com/sloppy. And greet people with your butt first.
Okay, we are back, and our special guest is here with us today. The breakout star in everything that she does. Writer, truly. Actor, comedian. You can catch her on screens literally everywhere and guessing on everyone's podcast. Literally, if you want your fill, you can get it. It's Mary Holland!
Yay! Hello! I love that being my tagline. If you want your fill, you can get it.
I mean, it's available to people.
It is available. That's true. That's very
you
true.
You work so much. You're everywhere. It's yeah. amazing.
Well, thank you. I'm so excited to be here and talk to you both.
Thank you.
I am so curious. Obviously, we have so much to talk about. You have like a new movie out and all these things, but I'm curious about your Hollywood journey. Because you, to me, I met you personally through our mutual friend, Lauren Lapkus, who
yes.
we sort of talk about all the time on the show, and she's been on the podcast. And you strike me as sort of like the least Hollywood person that there is. in fact, to the point, like when I met you, I was like, wow, she's so nice. And then I think I started following you on Instagram or whatever, and I saw you like posing on like a red carpet or like doing some press thing. And I was like, oh, she does that? Like, it didn't even like, it almost like yeah. I literally thought you'd be like, no, thanks, I'm good. I'll just show up to do the acting job. Like, it's just, there's nothing about you that seems like spotlight. I'll take it.
Oh, and then boy.
It's so, but it's so funny because you're so good in everything that you do. And you're like, you really are like a standout. Every time you watch something and Mary pops up, you're like, oh, more of that, please.
Oh, my gosh.
So I'm curious
thank you.
About your like Hollywood journey.
Thank you so much for those lovely words. I love the spotlight.
Okay, good.
Ooh.
I seek it out wherever I can. If anybody's like, hey, I want to take pictures, I'm like, I'll do it. I love it. I love it. I love it a lot. But my Hollywood journey, I feel like, well, I moved out here 13 years ago, over 13
oh,
years ago.
Okay.
From
yes.
where?
I came here straight after college. So, yeah, I went to college in DeKalb, Illinois, which is a
That's
suburb
right.
of
Illinois
Chicago.
State University.
Northern Ooh. Illinois University.
Oh, Northern Illinois. So that's
but close.
NISU?
Just NIU.
NIU. Okay, got it.
Home of the Huskies.
Yeah.
Everybody.
Do you remember that in shopping, like at JCPenney, they used to put Husky as a tag?
I do.
Yeah,
I was a Husky
wow.
boy, baby.
That was me.
It wasn't extended sizes. They didn't just call it bigger pants. It was, you got a Husky one on your hand.
It was called Slim, Regular, and then Husky.
And the thing about a Husky was the ankles were real tiny, but the top of it was real big.
Oh, man.
You looked like Humpty Dumpty. You were just like, wow.
Girl.
Wait, so you graduated yeah. college and you were
yes.
just like, it's LA for me, baby. There's no other choice.
I said, I have to go to the glitz and the glamour. we did like part of, so I the college I went to, there was, I was in a BFA acting program there. And part of the program was the graduating class would then do a showcase for like
sure.
agents and stuff. So we did that in Chicago, but then we also had, we were paired with an MFA class and they were highly motivated and really had their shit together. And they also got us showcases in New York and LA. And so my plan originally was to move to Chicago with the dream of someday moving to LA. But then when we did those showcases, it was my first time visiting LA and I really loved it. And I was like, well, I'm just going to come out here. So I did.
That's awesome.
So I did.
Yeah. In college, did you do musicals ever?
No. I love musicals. I simply can't. I don't
have the range.
I don't have the range. I don't have the, I don't, that's it. I don't have the range.
Is it the singing or the dancing?
It's the singing, and I personally think I can dance very well, but I'm sure a lot of people would disagree.
But is it like you don't have the pretty voice, but you could do the, didn't Carol Burnett do Once Upon a Mattress? Didn't she play like the princess and the pea?
Oh, did she? That's awesome.
And I think she was like, she just sort of did the singing regardless of the ability.
But that's
type
how
of
a
thing.
Lot of like great greats are. It's like they don't really, what's her name? Edith? No, Ellen. Anyway, so one of
Adina,
them, like,
it was
Idina Menzel. She doesn't really have the range, and yet she's out here killing it every time. Like, wow, what are we doing?
What are we doing? Okay,
what are we doing?
So you came to LA. What got you first into improv and like that? Because that's how I know you.
Right. I did like a summer intensive at IO in Chicago between my junior and senior year of college. And then when I moved to LA, I moved into an apartment building that happened to be right close to the Upright Citizens Brigade Theater. And so I just geographically, like, I don't know how long it would have taken me to find that place if I had not lived close to
do you mean on Franklin? Because they hadn't
Franklin,
opened the other one yet, right?
No. This was in 2007. And I think the Franklin one had just opened like 2 years prior. So it was still kind of a new place. And I went and saw shows and I was like, oh, this is improv. I was like, oh my God, this is improv. And
new choice.
Oh my God, this is improv.
thank you.
See, okay, so I do have the range. I saw the shows there and I connected the dots of like, oh, this is what I was learning in Chicago, and I signed up for classes, and then definitely that found my community there for sure.
Do you feel like, I'm so curious, because saying like I think I've been in LA now for 5 years, and I of course like lived in Chicago a little bit and then lived in New York, you know, been bouncing around. Do you feel like, I mean, saying like, oh, I've been here 13 years and like you have this, you have this amazing resume. So obviously it's like, it's the place for you to be. You're getting work, you're working hard, you're being successful. Like, do you feel like you are where you thought you were going to be? Do you feel like, I'm just so, I've always thought, oh, when I'm 40, that's when I'm going to hit my stride. Like, everything is sort of waiting until then. So I don't know. I'm curious how you see it.
I had really high hopes when I moved here, and big dreams, stars in my eyes, big dreams. And had a vision. I didn't really have, I wasn't tied to any specific timeline really, but I had goals that I wanted to achieve. Like I was like, gotta win an Oscar.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, but these are like a very much like way, like really, sure. Like, that is my dream of dreams. It did be do movies and all this stuff. And then I learned very quickly that just because you really want it to happen doesn't mean it will.
Sure.
And I, for like the first 8 years I was here, I auditioned a lot and never got anything. So so I feel like gradually over time I kind of learned to I think it really throwing myself in improv during that time too, I sort of let go of the like expectations that I had, or the specific dreams that I had attached to, and just kind of was like, let's see where this goes, like kind of living in the moment. And that was, I think, a big lesson.
I think a lot of people, a lot of my friends who I first, when I moved to LA, I was friends with, wanted to be actors so bad. And they were doing what you were saying. They were going to auditions all the time, but they weren't getting anything.
Right.
But they didn't have any other, they weren't going to UCB. They weren't taking any other classes. They weren't creating their own work.
Right.
And I feel like that's when people say LA will steal your soul, is like, you just keep getting rejected. But in my mind, it's like, why aren't you doing something that you love on the side, and then that will flourish and grow? Because like, you have all the energy for it. So it sounds like when you fell in love with UCB, you were like in it for the long haul. And you have been.
Yeah. And I completely agree with you. I think having that creative outlet where you can, where you're not waiting around for someone to give you permission to like, to do what you want to do, or like practice your craft or something. You're trying to make those opportunities for yourself. I think for sure that saved my life out here. Like I really, it's crushing. It's heartbreaking and it's crushing. And if you have that support system, but then also the outlet to like, perform in some way, even if it's in somebody's basement.
Yeah.
You know,
like even if it's in a dirty bar and I'm dancing around dressed like a lady for dollar bills. Well, at least I was doing something, Mom.
You're doing something.
But okay, so this brings up, I love the idea of taking a life skill from improv, of like getting rid of your expectation. I think a lot of people go like, oh, it helps you be confident, or it helps you think on your feet. But there's also like a philosophy that I think is like a cool thing to sort of apply about like just being flexible and going with the flow. And
I agree.
What other people have to say has value. Like, you're not allowed to just bulldoze through the world.
Right.
But I am very curious, because Meatball and I both, I assume this is true for you, Meatball, and I believe it is. Like, there
you
have
don't
been
know
a
me,
few,
bitch.
Few moments. Yeah, bitch. Say what you want to say. There have been a few moments in our careers where we get like called in to audition for something.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a different thing, because Meatball and I both sort of like have made our own personas, are like doing this like independent track. But then we like know people in the industry, or people, you know, are aware of us. So then we get like I had a friend write an episode of a TV show and they put me on a short list to go audition. But I am so not used to auditioning. So I went in and I bombed, floundered, like it was horrible.
What do you mean you bombed? Like, what does that look like?
I'll tell you what it looks like. And we can talk to Lauren Lapkus about who coached me through my audition ahead of time. I'll leave out all of the specifics, but I went into a casting call. It was the part was for a queer nightlife performer. Mm-hmm. And the person who wrote the part said they literally based it on the idea of me. So I figured, great. But as with anything, of course, that idea sort of morphed once it hit the page. So there was some singing that had to happen. And we all know that I sing better with the help of a computer than, you know, just a cappella. So anyhow, I had to go into the audition. I had to vamp like I was on a microphone. And then I had to sing. And I was talking to Lauren. I was like, the singing sort of makes me uncomfortable. And she was like, well, do what you do confidently. And we decided that I would strip, because that's what I do at my live show. So I walked into a room with a man, his assistant, and a camera, and he put a lav on me, on my overalls.
Oh no, but you're going to take those off.
I sure am, but I didn't have the foresight.
Oh,
so
no.
We put the lav on, I do the things, I'm shaking. I do the lines. I'm like looking at the camera, next to the camera, like, I don't know, whatever. And then it gets to the singing point and I start stripping. And the moment I like flip the bib down on the overall, like the mic literally like popped off the cord and bounced on the room.
Oh.
And I stripped down to a Speedo in a room with these two strangers who it's not like they did research on me, knew what I was about. And then they're just working at the casting office to put the damn thing on the tape to send to the director. Like, they don't know. And they're like, what? Like, completely shocked that I have taken all my clothes off in a regular. Like, theoretically, someone could have gotten very upset with me for doing that.
Right.
It wasn't sexually aggressive, but I did remove almost all of my clothing.
I feel like it might have been aggressive. I feel like maybe to you it wasn't, but to them, might have been aggressive.
Was there like an understanding of like, you can do whatever you want with this song? Like, we want to see how you would perform it.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Well, hey, you know, Did you get it?
Nope, I sure didn't. And so any of those, I have never, so again, what I'm saying is I've been called in maybe a handful of times, half a dozen times.
Right.
Never gotten it and never felt ever comfortable in that scenario. But I'm like, I could walk into a nightclub and I could pass my phone to the DJ and I said, play these two songs, give me a mic, and I could work the room.
Yeah.
And so those things are so different.
Yes.
It's Let me tell you about my terrible audition.
Oh, yes.
Oh, great.
Because I had to show up in full drag to this thing for a razor company that will be unnamed. I show up and there's no other drag queens. Normally when I'm cast for something, I just see a bunch of my friends there. This was all just dudes in there, just hairy dudes and me. And I'm sitting in the waiting room and I'm like, okay, so this is very uncomfortable because of course everyone's staring at me like, what are you doing here? And I just start making small talk and just like start going into my jokes to get everyone in the room to laugh in the audition room. Or not in the audition room, in the waiting room. And so when they call me in, I walk in and I'm like loose. I'm giving them like meatball, which is just inappropriate. And they were like, okay, so this is a razor commercial. So what part of yourself do you think you'd feel comfortable shaving? And I just ripped my dress open to show my hairy chest. And then they handed me a razor and I go, this is just a cheap plastic one. What, we're not going to use the actual brand? Okay. And like, I was just going off on these people.
And it was the actual brand?
No, it was not. It was a really shitty, they were, and I was like, oh, so what? We like, and I was just doing all that. And then later, like the billboard came up in Times Square and it was my friend. And I was like, oh I didn't even know that you auditioned.
Oh man. It is really, it's very tough. The auditioning process is, it's just, there's, I don't know anybody who's comfortable in that situation. Like it, I feel like you really, that it's such a, it's a skill, but it's also not, it's entirely random and you don't ever know what you're walking into or what the like vibe is going to be. And like having the pressure of, okay, I perform, like, it's just really, it's very tense. And it for creative people to like be in that very, structured environment where it's like you deliver the thing and then you go, like we're not like brainstorming or collaborating. Yeah. We're not like, let's making warm up a show together. Yeah, exactly.
But I do think it's funny because people always say they're like, everyone is rooting for you. They want you to come in and they want to give you the role. And you're like, yeah, of course they do, because they want to find the best person. They're also really ready to tear you down because
lived in New York, I was an assistant for auditions, and like the minute people would leave the room, it would just be like, fuck this, that guy is terrible at this, he said this weird, and I was like, wow, this is what it's like on the other side.
Oh, well, they're rooting
for
you.
What a nightmare.
If you're right for the part. Yeah.
Yes, like that's, if you're not right for the part, boo!
Boo, fuck yeah.
Let's get back to you and your acting career.
Yeah, do you have an audition story?
I have so many. And when I say, like, I auditioned for 8 years, having gotten nothing, hundreds of things. I have saved all the auditions I've ever had. I have them all in a very special folder that I like to access when I want to feel shame. And I had hundreds, went on hundreds. And I was lucky to get to do that, like to go out for these things. But never getting anything after going out that much is a special kind of demoralizing. There are so many times, so many auditions I experienced where I was like, okay, I want to use this opportunity to perform, to like, to have fun and do what I want to do and make a choice.
Right.
And
love a choice.
And I remember, there's like one story that I always think of when I think of a time I made a choice. And it was when I was auditioning for this pilot, and the role I was auditioning for was a buttoned up kind of prim receptionist, super Christian, very bubbly. And
sounds great to me for you.
Yeah. I would love it. I felt this. I was like, this is great. I love this. I wore a blue button up shirt And the waiting room was completely packed. And so the audition was running behind. I think I was in the waiting room for like over an hour. Oh, and wow. In the course of that time, my shirt like really showed sweat. And so I had sweat through. I had these giant damp like circles under my arms. Uh-huh. And I said to myself, use it.
Oh, no.
I said, you know what? This is a golden opportunity to use this for my character. And it's going to be genius. And in the sides, the other character has the first line. And then my character's line is responding to that. And so the plan I came up with was I'm going to pretend like my character is noticing that her armpits are sweaty. And she's going to be like, oh, like occupied and like thinking, oh no, you know, and then the other character is going to come in and say a line and then I'll be caught in this intimate moment. And it'll like inform that next line in such a way that it's such a cool choice. And so I went in there. And the cast, I feel like there were two women in there and they were lovely. And they're like, okay, you ready to get started? And I said, yes. And I lifted my arm up. And just as I planned, I started like gently like, oh, examining my sweaty armpit as my character. And I waited for that first line. And I waited and I waited. And the first line never came. And after like a minute or two of me truly just poking my wet armpit, I
cannot believe.
I looked up and I was like, so should I start or should I say the, I think you have the first line. And they were like, oh yeah. sorry. And it was really bad.
I don't want to presume to know.
Was probably like, if I were them, I feel like I'd be like, oh, she needs a minute. Yeah. She's taking a minute and she'll let us know when she's ready. But little did they know, I was using my environment for my performance.
Now, if you were to make that choice again, do you think you would say something like, I'm going to start with a bit or say something like that to sort of allow them to help you be successful?
Yes. That's such a great way to put it. Allow them to help you be successful. I think it would have been so, and it would have like made it more fun for them as well to like know what was going on.
We're
going to
do a thing, guys.
Guys, we're going to do a bit. but the environment, like as an actor walking into that, you just feel so, you feel so much pressure. You feel so nervous. Mm-hmm. You want to like have some banter with the people that you're auditioning with, so you can feel more relaxed and like feel more playful. But there's this formality too about it where like you come in and you're like, okay, and I stand here and I think that formality, like it definitely prevented me from communicating my needs in that moment.
Yeah, it's good to communicate your needs.
You gotta communicate your needs.
Well, let's take a quick break and we will be right back with more Mary Holland.
Ooh, baby, it's that time again.
That's right. We're going to talk to you about BetterHelp. Was that harmony?
No.
Well, we need some BetterHelp to get us there. BetterHelp is professional counseling done securely over the internet. They'll assess your needs and match you with your own licensed professional therapist.
Yes, and it's professional counseling done securely online, and you can start communicating with your counselor in under 48 hours.
They have a broad range of expertise available, which might not be locally available where you live, but it is available on the internet.
Ooh, baby. You can also log into your account at any time and send a message to your counselor, and you'll get a timely and thoughtful response. Plus, you can schedule a weekly video or phone sessions from home. I will never leave my house again.
Well, that's right. Then you don't have to go wait in a waiting room or touch a dirty-ass Highlights magazine.
Mm,
growth. BetterHelp is committed to facilitating great therapeutic matches, so they make it easy and free to change counselors if needed.
So check out that BetterHelp. That's Better H-E-L-P. And join the over 1 million people who have taken charge of their mental health with the help of an experienced professional.
Sloppy Seconds listeners, you get 10% off your first month at BetterHelp.com/sloppy.
That's BetterHelp.com/sloppy for 10% off your first month.
Stay safe and healthy, everyone. Ooh, ah! It's a new year. And we're back. Have you ever seen Wicked?
Yes.
Ooh.
Yes.
Do you love?
I saw it at the Pantages right here in Hollywood.
Oh, nice.
Yes, I saw it with Lauren Lapkus, actually.
Oh, oh, wonderful. Friend of the pod.
Yes. What,
so who is your favorite Elphaba?
Oh, this is easy. It's so easy. Yeah. I love this. I love this question. Oh my gosh, my favorite. I know I said it was easy, but it's actually really hard. Question.
And can you see the years that she, the span of time in which she played Elphaba?
Yeah.
And was it on Broadway or on the national tour or the second national tour?
Yeah.
And how does her riff sound?
It was Emily Cook. Now, have you ever...
Great. Yep. I agree.
Yeah. Yeah. She's wonderful.
Yeah. Amazing.
Now, we actually, last week, our guest was Jinx Monsoon, who was featured in your movie, Happiest Season, now
on
Hulu.
Hulu.
Which, you are so fucking good. Funny. You stole the show. It was so incredible. What was it like writing that and being a part of that whole situation?
Such a dream. I met Clea working on Veep a few years ago.
Yeah.
And we never had any scenes together, but we saw each other at the table reads and we just really connected very quickly. We had this lovely chemistry with each other, and she had the idea for Happiest Season and was looking for somebody to write it with her. And after we met, she asked me if I wanted to write it with her, and I said, yes, please. And the writing process was so much fun. Clea is just a wonderful human, and she's so funny. And knowing she wanted to direct it right off the bat, you know, she really had all the way through the writing process. It was so great to have that director's vision, like, guiding the story as we were telling it. So it was really cool. I learned a ton from that process, but such an honor to be in this story. And then to have the amazing people we had, like Jinx and Dela and all these amazing performers, come and be a part of it. We're just so lucky.
It was such a good movie. And we were actually just talking about it before you had come on, but one of my big qualms with sitcoms and rom-coms of today is that technology kind of gets in the way of telling the story. Because back in the day, it would be like, oh, you can't call them, there's no cell phones and all of that. And y'all somehow integrated all of that into it and made it part of the story. I love the mom with just the iPad the whole time, because I was like, that's my iPad. Fucking mom. That is her at the holidays taking pictures of everything. Like, how did y'all come up with all of that? Was that just people in your lives?
I feel like we just sort of brainstormed these characters into being. They're definitely not. Jane is the only character we wrote because I said I wanted to play her, so we wrote her knowing I would play her. So that's the only character we wrote like with somebody in mind. But we created this world of characters just purely on its own. But this having the specifics, it was so fun to like delve into the specifics of each of these characters, make them super three-dimensional, and then have their own sort of character games that they're playing throughout the movie. Like Tipper with the iPad was a really fun discovery. And yeah, I mean, I think also like once you populate this, you start populating this family with these characters, that informs how you create the other characters around. Like knowing we wanted Harper's family to be very, repressed or like sort of restrained, buttoned mm-hmm. up, then we knew we wanted to have somebody in that family who was a very different energy, and that's where Jane yeah. came from.
what I really appreciated about it, because it is sort of tricky to write like a closeted movie in 2020. Obviously, like the world exists and there are plenty of yes. people who all have different stories.
Yes.
And, you know, there are people who are closeted or will live their entire life closeted. And so, but we see so many like Queer Eye, and obviously like the main, you know, queer narrative, lesbian narrative, gay narrative is not I'm hiding it all the time, like right. there is, but what I liked about it is that everyone sort of, like, all the kids, you know, Jane's was more of her own personal secret of just wanting to be included, but I yeah. like that it wasn't just about being gay. It was yeah. like, as a family, we've sort of like repressed these feelings. And
yeah.
like, my thing is your approval, and my thing is my gayness, and my thing is acceptance.
Yeah.
And I appreciated that, because sort of initially, I remember when I saw the preview, I was like, oh, I love all these people. This is exciting to see like a lesbian Christmas movie. Like I don't know that exists anywhere.
Right.
Until
right.
you guys wrote this movie, you know? But there was like a moment when I was like, oh, is it really going to be like a coming out story? Like that, there's something about that, you know, and that is an evergreen narrative for,
yeah.
for queer people everywhere. But it is that hard thing. It's like, as a gay person, you want to watch celebration.
Totally.
And so what I appreciated is, like, you know, the foothold in reality of like, this is mm-hmm. hard and challenging and people go through this all the time. But then there was such a great celebration and acceptance at the end, which was so fun.
I thought it was great the whole way through. And I love that, like, right when it came out, the memes on Twitter, I was like, I have to watch it. Like, what is it like to see just like something that you wrote just blow up so quickly?
It is really overwhelming. It's I'm so massively grateful for the amazing support that the movie's got, and that so many people have watched it. And yeah, I thank you so much for all your lovely words about that story, because I think, you know, Clea especially took such great care with the storytelling and wanting it to be really rooted in an honest experience, and like not shying away from the difficulty that people face sometimes in this process. And also having the family each have journeys of their own and things that they are revealing to their family also for the first time. Like they're all kind of having this moment where they realize they don't know each other. And that is a right. really powerful thing to watch a family go through, you know, in addition to Harper's personal journey that she's on. But yeah, it is really, it's so exciting. It's very vulnerable. It feels really scary to like, because when you put something out there, when you make something, anything, there's a certain vulnerability that comes with that, because you're sort of giving it to people, and like they can have their opinions about it or feel however they want about it. And you can't guide that experience yeah. for people. So you just like hope that what you wanted to achieve with that particular story, you are able to do that. And I feel like Clea and I both, have received such positive feedback and support about it. And it, but yeah, it's very overwhelming. People think Riley is hot. But honestly, everybody in that movie is so beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was going to say, that's like a
gorgeous.
Was there like a moment as you guys were like, well, I guess I don't know. Were you involved in the casting, or sort of like, like once you guys finished writing it, it was sort of like Clea and the producers.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Were you, was there a moment when like Clea was like texting like, oh, Dan Levy's going to do it. And then it's like, oh, we got Kristen. And then it's like, oh, Aubrey's coming. It's like, were you just like, what the fuck is happening?
That's insane.
Yeah.
The cast is wild.
It's wild. Victor Garber.
Yes, of course.
Victor yes. Garber. And a gay.
Royalty.
Royalty.
Victor Garber.
All hail.
Jesus.
Yes, well, very lucky.
I mean, how incredible. How great. What a fun.
How stunning.
What a great thing to have in the holiday season.
Very excited. Very lucky. Thank you so much for your support.
Yeah, no of course.
Problem.
Now, I have a more, like a sort of like a more philosophical question.
Mm.
Okay.
And it's about this Kristen Stewart.
No,
do
this
you
is
think
great.
That she was a very good Charlie's Angels, or are you more of
she was in Charlie's Angels
she
too.
Yeah, she was in the reboot. But are you more of a Cameron so Diaz Charlie's Angels? Movies.
I have to confess I haven't seen the most
either
recent.
One.
Well, I can leave.
Well,
now.
No, I've
leave
seen, I saw
meeting.
The no, I haven't seen the most recent Charlie's Angels, so I'm gonna have to wait to weigh in on that, but I'll keep mm-hmm. you posted.
Perfect airplane movie for when this is all over.
Yeah.
Nice.
When you want to sort of be asleep and drunk at the same time while you're watching a movie on the airplane. Because you like wake up and you're like, new outfits. Oh, there's a gunfight. And you sort of go to sleep again. And then, no.
New outfits.
Here's my like philosophical question. The cast is amazing. You've been in a lot of things. Like you did many episodes of Veep. You were on Blunt Talk for the span of the show. You were in that movie with Mike and Dave Need Wedding Day. Like you do projects with so many actors, many of whom are also not only actors but celebrities, like very very famous people. So my question is, like, I think in this industry there are people who work all the time, successful, great, have a great career. And then there are the people who also do that, but then they also really tap into that celebrity culture.
Yeah.
Talk shows, tabloids, nightlife, party, you know, like whatever, brand endorsement. You know, they figure out that it's two revenue streams. It's acting and it's my name face on things.
So when are we going to see Mary Holland for Flat Tummy Tea?
That's
or
what I'm talking
for my
about.
Tushy or Selling Bags?
I don't know if you know, I already represent Flat Tummy Tea. I love it. I love Flat Tummy Tea. Yeah, it's my favorite thing in the world, you guys. I'm a great spokesperson for it, hey? that's so true that there is that is a whole nother aspect of a career in like the entertainment industry that some people do. I feel like also some people involuntarily become that. Like some people become so famous so fast that they're sort of thrust into that celebrity sphere, maybe without totally wanting to be that that visible. But yes, it is. It's. I mean, I did my first talk show experience. Clea and I went on Kelly Clarkson together recently,
which
it was so fun. But it is a real. It's a real skill to be able to like be yourself, but then also be aware that you are a product in a way. And I think some people have really tapped into honing that and being so comfortable with that where they're just like are effortless with it. But it is really daunting to me, that whole side of things of like instead of the like the doing the work and the work becoming famous,
right?
You as a person becoming famous is a different thing entirely. And that feels really intense.
Yeah.
Do you think that, I mean, like, cause it seems like that sort of happens for younger people, you know, like when they're young and it happens and it feels like, oh, well they want me to go to this party and then I get photographed on the way into the party. And it's like, you've lived in LA for a while. You're like booed up. You've got your work, you've got your things that you do. So it's just like, you're like, if you were to ever become like crazy famous, do you think you would just become a mess?
Absolutely.
Because I know Meatball would.
I would fall apart completely.
I would be the next Amanda Bynes.
Yes. If Meatball ever got famous, you would...
It'd be face tats and bad decisions.
And why do you say that? What do you mean?
I have no self-control. And if people invite me to stuff or like ask me to do stuff, I do it because I just am like, cool, I'm here.
Yeah.
So I feel like I would just get kind of sucked into doing a lot of stuff because I just want to be around more people. Yeah. But also, I think that's a product of where I'm at right now, like being locked inside for 9 months.
I think we all sort of feel that way right now. But yeah, I know what you mean. I think that I can't imagine that ever happening. But if it were to, I feel like my response would be to retreat.
Mm.
It
would
be run deep into the woods. And never emerge. Emerge if it's a great project.
Emerge for the work. Well, I want to talk a little bit about Wild Horses.
Yeah.
No.
So Wild Horses is, you said no?
I politely declined? I politely say no. No. Yes, let's talk about it. Yeah, love it.
So Wild Horses is... you and Lauren and Stephanie and Aaron.
Mm-hmm.
Lauren Lapkus, Stephanie, you pronounce her last name Allen?
Allen. Mm-hmm.
And then Aaron Whitehead.
Yes.
Do you call yourself an improv group, a comedy collective, a talk show?
Comedy collective.
A talk show. Yeah.
I don't know.
I love a comedy collective. I think we call ourselves a improv group.
A book club?
We call ourselves
really
a book club.
Do it all.
I remember we've actually had this conversation recently on a podcast. All four of us were a guest on the Pants podcast, which is Leisha Haley and Kate Menig's podcast. And they were asking us about like how we define ourselves, an improv group or team. And it was very interesting, the conversation of like, oh, do we call ourselves a team? Because that's usually the vernacular that's used around like an improv theater. You have all these teams.
Troop.
Troop, yes. yeah, I think that is how we define ourselves. And we actually just did our first show in many months just this past weekend, a virtual show. And it was so fun.
Well, it's great because you do a really unique format in that you like sit and like drink a little cup of wine and chat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just
yeah.
chat.
We just
that
and
wink
chat.
You gave with the wine.
Yeah, I know. So you like the cup of wine.
No, wine.
And then you bring out your guests and then you also chat with your guests. And then at the end of it, and what I love about it is, I mean, it's sort of like, it's honestly like a live podcast, which is why it translates so well to people mm-hmm. listening to it in podcast form.
Right.
Because right. It sort of feels like, oh, all of you are good at parties. So therefore this makes it, it's just like very entertaining conversation. You know what I mean?
I mean, I think we really love each other and love spending time together and are very comfortable with each other. So I think that invites a familiarity also with the audience. I am not good at parties. So that's so interesting that you say you're all great at parties because I feel the opposite way.
Well, you're
really?
Good at,
why? What?
Good at a
what?
Party of five.
Good at a reference. Party of five. Starring Jennifer Love Hewitt.
Ooh.
I'm not good at parties. I have terrible social anxiety. It really flares up when there's a lot of people around, and I feel like everybody hates me. That's when it really gets bad. But
well, how are you walking onto a set, like into a room full of people about to have to act? Do you feel any anxiety about that, or are you like, I'm doing a character. This is going to be easy.
I think there is the. There are a ton of people on a set, but we have like a thing that we're all working on. Mm-hmm. And I feel like at a party, it's just like, okay, everybody talk. And that's where
like,
I get like,
where are the lines?
Yeah. It's nice to like have a task to focus on, mm-hmm. you know, like that's why I love the kind of parties that are my favorite are like game nights or something where we're all like working on something together. We're all doing something.
Mm-hmm.
so yes. Yeah, so Wild Horses, you chat, and then
we chat.
Your guest comes out, you ask them some questions, mm-hmm. and then you improvise based on the conversation you had.
That's right. And I remember when you were our guest, there's a picture from the conversation we had with where all... I know Lauren and I were. I feel like Stephanie and Aaron were like leaned over laughing, but Lauren and I both were on our feet screaming. And there's a picture of us just like reacting to things that
what did you say?
Us. What do you think? I was telling them some story about some hookup with some like man.
Wow. It was probably about amazing. Fisting.
No, it was about, I remember exactly what it was. It was about when I was traveling in Portland, I like had some guy like come over to the hotel room so I could suck him off. And when he got there, I was like laying on the bed and I was sucking his dick, and he like sort of leaned over so I could like sort of see up, you know, behind the ball sack into the ass crack.
Ew.
And there were some dingle berries, you know, like toilet paper.
Why would you?
And it literally everyone stood up and went
it's so horrible.
It's horrible. I applaud you for telling it again.
It's real life. It happened.
It's real life.
I wasn't into it. I wasn't like, please bring the dingleberries to the hotel room hookup.
No,
but that would have been an ideal time to be like, now's the time to order your Hello Tushy and get some water on that booty hole.
Hey, let me tell you something. Flat tummy tea will do it for you. I'm telling you, flat tummy tea. You got to get some, everybody.
Tushy is sponsoring this episode, by the way. That's
oh, good.
Oh,
that's perfect. Good. Great. We can cut one ad out.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah, so do you, because you all have really frank conversations, but we do a segment here on our show called Fuck Talk.
Fuck Talk.
Where Thoughts? We talk about fucking.
Okay, good face. It was a good response. Yeah, this is a portion where we just talk about weird, uncomfortable hookups that we've had in the past, or something very funny along the lines of the dingleberry, but not gross. You know, some
yeah,
fun.
Yeah, okay.
And like do you have any fun stories?
Well, what I was going to say, I was going to sort of lead Mary into this because I, you know, it's
great.
Like, I don't know you that well, so I don't know how comfortable you are with sharing these types of stories, but... When I feel like I said something like this, and then when we were doing Wild Horses, I said that dingleberry story, and you responded something like, I thought like my first kiss at church camp, like in the basement, was some sort of like scandal, and you're talking about dingleberries on an asshole.
Yeah, I didn't. That's Olympic level. I did that. I,
oh Lord.
I'm trying to. Listen, I've done it a lot.
Oh, sex?
Yeah, oh, I've done it
good for
a lot.
You. Way to go.
A lot. Like
we love
so
people
much.
Do it a lot.
So much. It's crazy. Like
that's so nuts.
I know.
why don't we, instead of forcing you to talk about it, why don't we play a voicemail from one of our callers?
Oh, yeah.
And then you can just judge their story.
I love that.
That sounds like a better idea.
Do you have one for me, Meatball?
Let me text it to you right now.
Hi, Big Dipper. Hi, Meatball. My name's Jordy. I live in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And my Fuck Talk story is actually about the first time that I ever saw Big Dipper. He came to Dick's Milwaukee, where I was working at the time, and did a set. Our microphone was kept cutting out. And I was like, is somebody like... censoring his bad words, and I was like, nope, it's just our microphone being shitty. Anyway.
I'll pause it for a second, and that is all very true. They had like one of those shitty like karaoke like talk over microphones. So when you're doing live music to that, and the music gets lower when you try to rap on top of it, and then also the signal kept cutting out. So we literally we'll keep going.
Okay, my story is about that night. So later that night I was very drunk, and there's this cute guy, or I thought he was cute at the time. He like wanted me really bad, and I was like, okay, like let's go home. And he was like, cool, come with me. And I was like, all right. Then we like pull up to his house in his car, because I was like a responsible person who doesn't want to drink and drive. Pull up to his house, and he's like, so you can't come in. And I was like, what? He's like, yeah, my husband's in there. We have to do it right here in the car. And I was like, cool, that's fun. Do you have lube? And he was like, no, I don't have any lube out here or whatever. So anyway, long story short, he has a refrigerator in his garage and there's butter in it for some reason. I don't know. Maybe he's like, it wasn't Crisco, so maybe it wasn't the thing. I don't know what he was using butter in his garage for. Anyway, it's not that crazy, but like we had sex in his garage and used butter for lube. It was a great time. And then afterwards, like, I usually prefer to cuddle, like a good bottom. He didn't want to do anything. He was like, hey, I got to go back inside. Can you call yourself an Uber? And he just, like, left me in his driveway, dripping with butter. Yeah, that was the end of the night. It was not great. But that's my story. Also, Meatball, I need more riffs from Wicked. I've seen it a bunch of times, and I don't get enough. Thanks, bye-bye.
You were left in the driveway with butter dripping out of your ass.
Okay,
I'm
Mary,
sorry.
Thoughts
I didn't
on
know
that?
It was gonna be gross like that.
No,
did you,
I
you
love
know
it.
You that you were uplifting the queer community with your film, and this is what we do for you. So
we bring you right back
it.
Down.
I listen. I know a ton of people who keep butter in their garage. what a story! Oh my gosh!
What a story.
I mean, I have to say, I'm disappointed that. That he was left to get himself home. That's
right?
Disappointing.
Like, shouldn't he call an Uber after
yes.
he, like, butterballed him?
At the very least, provide transportation safely
and
back
a paper
home.
Towel.
And, yes, ideally a paper towel because butter is, it's not, look. Butter is, have you guys ever, okay, hear me out. Have you guys ever, like, tried, okay, let's say you use a butter knife, okay, right? Uh-huh. And you've mm-hmm. got butter on the butter knife, you put butter on the toast, you still got some residual butter left on the knife, and you think like, oh, I'm just going to rinse the knife off and, there's no such thing as a quick
exactly.
rinse. You have to fully wash that to get the butter off. So butter, that what a substance to use because that really
it's not going anywhere.
It's not going anywhere.
You
That's gonna
some,
last.
You need something to get that slick gone.
Ugh!
What a treat! What a treat!
Okay, so have you ever heard of someone using butter for lube?
Just now.
Yeah.
This was the first time.
I've heard of it.
Oh.
You have?
No.
Because, okay, people using Crisco as lube is something that gets talked
Don't
about a lot.
Don't do this to
in
Mary.
The gay community because
Don't
people do
stop it.
Fisting and
stop.
People use Crisco to actually do the fisting.
Well... Sure. So it's not. So
anything slick and wet, the gays will find a way to put it up.
That'll
their butt.
Do it.
And yeah. that is the truth. We're just looking for any new liquid.
And household, how fun to have, because butter is so versatile.
Yes.
And just add it to the list of things you can use. With or you can use butter for.
Yeah, you can use butter for toast, as you were saying. Butter is great.
Toast.
Turkey basting. Have you ever butter basted a steak? Delicious.
Oh, that is so
delicious.
Good.
Yes, a little garlic, a little rosemary. What's your favorite thing
yes.
to cook? What's,
yeah,
what's your favorite thing to cook at home?
What's your go-to meal?
Favorite thing to cook? Oh, man. My go-to meal is probably skin-on, bone-in chicken thighs
Ooh.
With roasted onions and broccoli. And I make it all in one cast iron pot or cast iron, like, skillet dish. And I put that in the oven. And I just roast that for a good 30 minutes at 450. And it is just so succulent and delicious. Lots of olive oil, of course, salt, pepper. But it's very simple, and that is my go-to. That's the thing that I'll make if I have to make dinner and I Like, I don't have many recipes that are just, like, in my head, but that's one of them.
That sounds delicious.
Has cooking always been a thing? I feel like in the last couple years, I'm like, no, I would, like, obviously I love to obviously have someone else cook for me and just grab food and eat it, you know?
Yeah.
But I have a much more, I much more, like, appreciate cooking, preparing food, and being like, I made this for myself and I'm happy I did this.
Yeah.
Is that a thing that you experience?
It is, and it's something I also it does not come naturally to me. But my husband is an amazing cook, and so I am very much actually in the position of just showing up and eating because he really enjoys cooking too. So he's happy to do it, but I'm trying to get better about it. And the times that I do, it takes me, if a recipe says it'll take 10 minutes of prep time, it'll take me an hour.
Oh yeah. Same. Those things a lie.
Who is chopping a full onion in under 30 minutes?
Nobody. Nobody.
Nobody. Those time estimates. If I'm in charge of dinner, because I asked Matt if we could do this during quarantine, because I do want to get better about cooking. And I agree, the ritual of it is so nice. So we will trade off nights that we're cooking. So if it's my turn to cook, I know that I need to start getting into that kitchen around 5 o'clock, even if we're going to eat at like 7:30 or 8, because it takes me so long.
That's so nuts.
You're like, honey, get the butter.
Get the butter out of the garage. Out of the garage.
Go, I only want garage butter from now on.
I don't want the butter that's in the refrigerator in the kitchen.
I wanted to have finger marks in it where it was scooped out.
Okay.
Okay, too far. Too far. See, that was the one that went too far.
The logistics of it. I do have a lot of questions about the logistics of, like, how, what, was it, was it a stick of butter? Was it a tub of butter? Because that's going to change it.
And did he, like, scoop it out and then sort of warm it up to turn it into the liquid lube?
Okay.
Or did he sort of, like, push it in cold? All right, listen.
I was imagining a thing, a country crock. Like, remember those buckets of butter, like, grandma's would have?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Isn't country crock.
Well, this has been such a lovely episode.
We appreciate you being here.
We really went on all the ups, the downs. I had a wonderful time talking to you, Mary Holland.
I had a fabulous time. Thank you so
Thank
much,
Thank you
Meatball
so much
Big
for
Dipper.
Coming.
So where can people find you?
I have great news,
yes,
everyone. I have synced up my Twitter handle and my Instagram handle. So now, across all platforms...
Don't you love saying that?
I love it. And by all platforms, I mean Instagram and Twitter. You can find me at Mary Hollandaise.
Like the sauce.
Speaking of cooking, like the sauce.
Well,
it's a great feed. I'm just sorry. I was just like looking
at it. Oh, yeah, you're just looking at it? Thank you so much for writing
this
a wonderful
gorgeous wedding photo.
Oh my God, that dress is stunning.
Thank you.
I guess you do like this.
Wait, what is that in the back? Is that flowers?
It's like a human floral
wreath. That is gorgeous. It's a giant wreath.
Yes, it's a pampas grass, which if that's that fluffy stuff, it's so beautiful. I want pampas grass around me at all times. It's just so ethereal. I love it so much. That, of course, is me holding a fake flower.
Oh, you got the butter on them fingies.
Yeah, we gotta get out of here. I gotta slip and slide all over my body. Okay, so watch Happiest Season on Hulu.
Yes, please.
Go find Mary guest starring in every single sitcom you've ever enjoyed. Your characters on Veep are great. Loved you on Blunt Talk. I feel like that was a show that was very popular and a major real show, but like I had literally never heard of it until it was over. And then I went back and watched it and I was like, I love this show.
Oh, I'm so glad. I don't
Showtime,
know.
Showtime, right? Or
it's
Stars.
On Stars. Stars.
Is it on so the Stars app? You can still go watch it, right?
Oh, no.
No.
I think it has been removed.
Get it out of here.
Patrick Stewart said no. I don't know what happened to it. You must be able to access it somewhere, but it's not on the Stars platform anymore. But yes, it was. It's a very interesting show from the brain of Jonathan Ames, who is so brilliant. So go see if you can find it.
Yeah, just look at her IMDb and watch the shows you want to watch, because they're all great.
They're all amazing.
Thank you.
Well, thanks so much for being here, and happy holidays and a happy new year to you, Mary.
And a happy holidays, a happy new year, a happiest season to you and yours. And I hope you all stay safe and happy.
Perfect
season. Thanks so much for listening to Sloppy Seconds. You can follow us on Instagram at Sloppy Pod or send us an email at sloppysecondspod@gmail.com.
You can follow me on Instagram at Spiciest Meatball and Big Dipper Jelly on everything at Big Dipper Jelly. And I'm on Twitter as Fat Drag Meatball. And don't forget to subscribe so you don't ever miss an episode, which now come out every Tuesdays and Fridays.
And remember, our phone number, which I didn't sing before, but I now will, is 213-536-9188888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888888 that face.
Good. That's gonna be fun. That's gonna be a fun one.
Yeah, you can't hang out with your newborn child. You have to underscore me yelling the number 8 100 times. Okay, bye.
I hope no one calls that number.
Doodle-a-doo-doo forever dog. To listen to Sloppy Seconds ad-free, sign up for Forever Dog Plus at foreverdogpodcast.com/plus.
Sloppy Seconds is produced by Forever Dog and Moguls of Media.
Mom! Hosted by Big Dipper and Meatball. Mixed and mastered by William Pitts.
Executive produced by Willem Belli, Alaska Thunderfuck, Brett Boehm, Joe Cilio, and Alex Ramsey.
Our artwork is drawn by Christian Cimarroni.
And our theme song was written by Mike Malarkey.